Good morning, everyone. Let us all prepare our hearts for our call to worship. Shall we all rise? Jesus is coming. He's riding on a donkey. Open the gates, open the ancient doors. Don't be afraid. Wave the branches, spread out your coats. Peace on earth, glory in the highest heaven. We tell your story, we follow in your footsteps. We walk towards the city, we visit or we wait in the garden. We journey towards death, we hope for resurrection. Lead us into the holy joy. O living God, on our journey through life, our hearts and our hands have become stained and tarred. Lord, forgive the sins of all who turn to you in sincerity. You cleanse the penitent heart of all uncleanness. Lord, set our course according to your word so that we may take up afresh the challenge of the journey to the holy city. Give us new strength to follow you in your way, so that even we may pass the gates of righteousness and stand upon the holy ground. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Please remain standing for our first song, Hosanna in the Highest. Let's sing Hosanna in celebration of the victory of our Lord. Let's draw close to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Draw me close to you. Never never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do, 'cause nothing else could take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace, help me find a way, bring me back to you. You're all I want. You're all I want. You're all I've ever needed. You're all I want. Help me know you. Draw ever closer. Draw me close to you. And never let me go. I lay it all down. To hear you say that I'm your friend, you are my desire. No one else will do, 'cause nothing else could take your place. Feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find the way and bring me back to you. You're all I want. You're all I ever needed. You're all I want. Help me know you are near. You're all I want. You're all I've ever
God, we cry out, Hosanna, you are the victor. You are triumphant. You reign over the earth. You reign over all of creation. You reign over our hearts. And it is a different kind of power. It is victory through surrender, not conquest. And so, Lord, we surrender to you as you've surrendered to us. Lord, may we come together as your people, understanding the meaning of your sacrifice, the meaning of the cross, your death and resurrection. And may we also die to ourselves our false selves, that we may be reborn anew to your likeness and image, that we may be Christ for this world that is dying. So Lord, we hope in you, we hope in your work, we hope in the promise that you'll make all things new. Bring newness to us even as we gather this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
It is time to give our offering this morning, and for the Easter lilies, your donation for the Easter lilies are still welcome. And if you guys do your offerings on the online, you know what to do, you know where to go, but please give our tithes and our offerings to the Lord.
Thank you.
Silence us any voices but your own, so that we may hear you, word, and also to do it. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. As I read the scripture this morning, it touches me because we went to Jerusalem. And as I read the scripture this morning, I might be in tears because I had felt it and I had experienced it, so as with a pastor. So let's prepare our hearts to hear the voice of God. It is found in the book of Mark, chapter 11, verses 1 through 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter, you will find the colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'What are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord needs it, and I will send it back shortly.' They went and found a colt outside the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there and asked, 'What are you doing, untying that colt?' They answered, and Jesus told them too, 'What are you doing, untying the colt?' They answered. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he said on it, many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut into the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he coming in the kingdom of your father, David. Hosanna is the highest heaven.' Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything. But since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. This is the word the Lord for the people of the Lord. She had suffered for 12 years and had spent all she had searching for a cure. Then one day, in an act of faith, this woman from Galilee quietly reached out to touch the hem of Christ's robe. She is instantly healed. The robe was just a piece of cloth, yet when Christ was present, there flowed a great healing power. As we gather here today, this could be just another choral presentation, but we pray that the Jesus Christ or the Spirit of Christ will live in our words and music as we invite you to come, encounter the presence and the power of Christ. Come, let's touch the robe.
Touch the robe.
What a powerful passage that was read to us with such a resounding voice and heart, and the anthem that was sung that is just so powerful as well. Today we celebrate Palm Sunday and the start of the Holy Week, one week that we set aside to be immersed in God's presence, immersed in the acts of Jesus in his 3 years of earthly ministry, and to immerse ourselves in our prayer for a contrite heart as we confess our sins and anticipate the rolling away of the stone and the resurrection. And that's just next Sunday, Easter Sunday. And our Easter Sunday will be a combined worship service at 11:30, an hour later than our usual time to accommodate for the Vietnamese-speaking members of our church. And we will come to celebrate as if to coming out of the darkness of the pandemic. Even if there is an active war around the globe, and even though there's a world that is not the kingdom of God as we pray and want it to be, we come because Jesus has already won victory for us on that cross. But today is centered around the action of Jesus riding on a donkey going into Jerusalem, knowing fully well that he was going in to be arrested and to suffer and to face death. One of the many symbols that you'll see in the banners behind me is a palm leaf. Do you see the palm leaf? It is a very important symbol, as it was used by many people, thousands of people that have gathered around Jesus's known as the triumphant entry into Jerusalem. Many people lifting their branches of something green, and particularly these palm leaves. And the palm leaves are very symbolic. We know even in our own history, in the years past, the branch that is palm branch is symbolic of victory, triumph, peace, eternal life. And it originates from this Near East and Mediterranean world ancient history about the use of this palm branch. You'll see it as symbols in many of the older buildings that you'll see in Europe and in the East, Near East and Mediterranean world. You'll even find palm leaves inscribed into coins, right, in some parts of the world. It symbolizes in Egypt immortality, eternity. A palm branch was awarded to victorious athletes for winning their whatever it was that they were winning in ancient Greece. And the palm tree itself is one of the most common attributes of victory. And a few years ago, we planted some palm trees out in the front, as you will see. Palm leaves representing victory were laid on the ground as Jesus was making his way into Jerusalem. In our gospel lesson today, Jesus is entering Jerusalem, and the people around him greet him with palm leaves to shout victory, immortality, peace, as Jesus humbly rode a donkey entering Jerusalem. And you ask today, what does that mean to us? What does this triumphant entry that Jesus makes represent for us today as we prepare for the Holy Week and Easter Sunday? Here in the context, we're near the end of Jesus's 3-year ministry. The disciples have been with Jesus in Galilee and the surrounding area for nearly 3 years. And Galilee, for most of them, have been their home, and they are comfortable there. Things have gone well in Galilee. Jesus went about teaching and healing, and the people loved him and followed him. The disciples witnessed marvelous things in the time of Jesus' ministry. At or near the Sea of Galilee in particular, Jesus healed the paralytic who was lowered through the roof. Do you remember the story? Jesus delivered a man possessed by a legion of demons. Jesus healed the woman with an issue of blood, the very story that the choir sang about this morning. Jesus healed the centurion's servant. Jesus fed thousands of people in the nearby hills overlooking the Sea of Galilee. And if you walk up the hills, you will see with the full view of the Sea of Galilee, which is really a huge lake, just envisioning Jesus speaking to thousands and feeding them. There up on the hill overlooking the Sea of Galilee, Jesus taught the Beatitude, the Sermon on the Mount. This is where Jesus walked on water at the sea. Jesus calmed the storm. Earlier, this is where Jesus met Peter, Thomas, Nathanael, James, and John, and 2 others fishing, and invited them to come and follow. But today, after many of these events, Jesus and his disciples were headed to Jerusalem. Maybe the disciples were baffled and confused. Why would Jesus walk into fire, knowing fully well that there was a commotion brewing to do something to hurt Jesus. This was the big city. This was the holy city, the home of the temple. This is the place where Jesus would be tried and dragged out. In our Palm Sunday scripture today, Jesus and his disciples were on the outskirts of Jerusalem at Bethpage and Bethany. Jesus sent two disciples into town ahead, not into Jerusalem, but into another village, and said, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.'" So the disciples hurried into the village, took a donkey, and brought it to Jesus. They and others laid their cloaks on the ground on top of the donkey to cushion Jesus's ride, perhaps. And Jesus sat on the donkey and rode into Jerusalem. As this was already prophesied in the Old Testament, that he would humbly walk into Jerusalem on a donkey. It is helpful for us to remember that wherever Jesus went, there were thousands of people that packed their lunches and maybe not even have their lunches ready, but followed Jesus in droves. They had heard about miracles, especially about Lazarus after being dead, being live, brought back to life again. Lazarus, the miracle, the story of Lazarus probably was the latest and the greatest sensation and made the front page of news among people speaking about this Jesus. Children probably brought their small little children to them, and we know that children were invited to Jesus. They went to try to touch him, and it was in that song that we sang about that was so powerful this morning, where this woman with the issue of blood couldn't even go touch and was hiding in the back and followed probably for a long time, and then had the courage to just barely touch the cloak and experienced something extraordinary. It was Passover, and there were many Jews going into the temple from all over the area, and was the custom to go to the temple on their pilgrimage. When Jesus entered Jerusalem on this little colt, people came and they spread cloak and palm leaves in front of Jesus as the donkey took its steps closer to the doors into the temple. The leaves paved the way. It was sort of like their way of rolling out the red carpet, right, to usher. And they all shouted together, "Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." What were these thousands of people shouting about? What were they really shouting about? What were they saying? What was the meaning behind the words, "Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David"? What do they mean by this, the coming kingdom of ancestor David? Imagine yourself among the thousands there, peeking, and for somebody as short as I am, I would have to maybe even climb up a tree. And we know somebody who has done that, not necessarily in that moment, but I could relate to that person that went up the tree. But the reference to David had been Israel's great king, Under David, Israel had been free and prosperous. It was good times. Under David, Israel had expanded its borders. Under David, Israel was stronger than it had ever been or would ever be. It was downhill after David's time. And by the time of Jesus' day, Israel was no longer powerful. It was in shambles. Rome was their boss. Roman soldiers roll the streets, exuding power. The Roman government ruled the country, and Israel was no longer free. They were treated as second class. We know what second class looks like. We face it, we see it here, even in the United States. They had taxation imposed by the Roman government over and above the Israel government. And much corruption with taxation to the point where tax collectors were looked upon as the most infamous people of all time. Roman soldiers would have stakeouts on top of these major cliffs and mesas where they would watch to see how long people would walk across the road so that they could charge these people for using the road. Very similar to cameras that we see on expressways today, and they send you a bill, right? And they take it out automatically if you set it up and such, so that you get emails once in a while. You're charged $3.85. Okay, when did I ever cross the expressway? But I'm sure I have, right? And this is what they did. They watched over, hovered over. Israel was no longer. And these people shouted, "Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David." I think what they had in mind at that point was that this Messiah would kick out the Romans and bring freedom to Israel, take them back to the good old days under David's reign. Though they couldn't say that plainly because they saw Roman soldiers all over. You know, their words were censored. And we know a little bit about that in some of our national histories of our personal place that we've come from. I know that for one, in Korea, much during the 50s and 60s and 70s, much of what we say could have easily gotten people arrested. So this was a very, very suspicious times, and they couldn't say out loud, shouting for their freedom. So symbolically, they shouted out the name. Good old days. Messiah, go in and kick everybody out and bring back Israel. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. They wanted injustice to be over, regain power, and be its own nation without the Roman power over them. Perhaps they wanted a war to be led by Jesus, the Messiah, to make their world a better place that way. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. The coming kingdom. They ushered it, they welcomed it, and they blessed it. But you and I know that this conquer, the coming of the days of the old, came in a very different way than how people anticipated. Jesus would usher in the blessed kingdom, all right, but not with a military force. Jesus was in the process of ushering the kingdom as he rode the donkey into Jerusalem that would know no borders or barriers, and would conquer all powers here on earth. It would be a kingdom to those who gave their hearts and minds to God. It would be a kingdom much more powerful than how Israelites experience the good old days of King David. It would be a kingdom much more powerful than what they had ever imagined. This kingdom that would be with no borders, barriers, and no end. Jesus was riding into the king, to the temple to do just that. He was going to bring in that blessed kingdom, and he was going to do it with the most powerful work. With the most powerful work of giving himself up to death. Leading up to the crucifixion on Friday, just a few days from today, lots of things would happen that week. Following this entry today, as you read from the second half, Mark 11, which I ask you to do, throughout this week, Mark chapter 11, you'll see these things happen, and it is written all the way through chapter 16. So I ask you to read Mark 11 through 16 during this Holy Week, maybe one chapter a day. Jesus, during this Holy Week, would cleanse the temple. The religious leaders would try to trap him, but in every case, they would find themselves caught in their own trap. Jesus would warn his disciples about the coming destruction of the temple and the city. Jesus would also warn his disciples of the persecution that they will face after the ascension of Jesus in the early church. The priests and scribes would begin to hatch a plot to arrest Jesus. Kill him. Not knowing of that plot, a woman would anoint Jesus' body with an expensive perfume. Judas, in the background, would agree with the chief priests to betray Jesus. Jesus would then gather his disciples to celebrate the Passover and would institute what we know today and celebrate as the Last Supper, or the Lord's Supper. Jesus would tell Peter that Peter would betray him three times. Roman soldiers would arrest him on Thursday night and take him to the priests, who would condemn him. Pontius Pilate would try Jesus, who would hand him over to the Jewish leaders to be crucified, and washed his hands clean. Then on Friday, Jesus would be crucified. Joseph of Arimathea, one of the Jewish leaders, would go to Pontius Pilate to ask for Jesus' body so that he, Joseph, could bury Jesus honorably. Joseph would prepare Jesus' body for burial and would bury him in a tomb. Then on the third day, on Sunday morning, Jesus would be risen. When Jesus entered Jerusalem and were greeted by thousands of followers, waving palm leaves and shouting Hosanna, saying, "Please help us now," waving their palm leaves, saying, "We want victory." Many of them felt that Jesus would somehow bring up a huge sword and pin down the oppressors and make everything come back to where Israel has been. Or maybe there were some, and I hope that would be all of us, in the midst, admiring Jesus and what Jesus had done, would know that Jesus' triumph entry and his actions in that Holy Week and his crucifixion that Friday morning, and the resurrection, and the ascension, knowing all of that from what was prophesied in the Old Testament, would swell up in our hearts, saying, now is the time. Now is the time when all that was prophesied in the Old Testament is coming to fruition. As was told, Jesus is riding on a donkey, as was specified in the Old Testament. Now it's happening. The story of salvation foretold in the days of King David is about to unfold in the days to come. The great ultimate victory, where Jesus would be cut off and suffer death, as described in Daniel 9. To become the ultimate triumphant Messiah. Can you say that with me? The triumphant Messiah. Say that with me again. Triumphant Messiah. And we all know, as the story unfolded and is the basis, as is the base of our faith, that Jesus overthrew the evil. Jesus conquered death so that we no longer have to face eternal damnation. Jesus, though he could have denied God and said, no, I can't do this, face the music, if you will, and proceeded into this victory through ultimate suffering unto death. The most powerful victory that you will ever know in human history. And that's why this triumphant entry becomes so important, because it was the beginning. It was the beginning of the end, fulfillment of God's promise of our salvation. Many of those thousands that have gathered became the first reborn Christians because they knew Jesus. This Jewish people had understood that God's promise of salvation had been fulfilled by Jesus. They saw the whole picture. They understood God's story of salvation. How does that affect us today? How does this triumphant entry and the story of the most powerful triumphant story affect us today? Sadly enough, I think some of us, some Christians, still are waiting for that Messiah to come and take away all of our difficulties in life so that we would live a life without any suffering. It is sort of the thousands of people who expected Jesus to hold up a sword and bring in a military power. But I believe that today, the way that Jesus works in our lives is bring us to his knees, to bring us to the same road of suffering, so that we too understand the more powerful journey, triumphant journey, in the footsteps of Jesus. You and I both know that there is suffering today. There's no doubt about it. We're in the full midst of suffering. And that's what life has to bring to us. And yet, with Jesus' entry into Jerusalem, knowing how the story will unfold, you and I must share in that triumphant entry into Jerusalem, into the journey of suffering for Jesus Christ, to be uncomfortable, to be with Jesus, to side with Jesus, to understand that in the midst of suffering, that God is with us. And the end story of suffering is that it doesn't end there, but that as Jesus was resurrected and was ascended, that we too will rise with Jesus when we unite with God. So rather than asking Jesus to come in with military power, we ask God to come into our hearts with his love, with his grace, with his mercy, to place us as we are, that he conquers fear, he conquers the iniquities in our hearts, and bring peace to our hearts today. So today, when you walk out, I want you to look for a palm tree. Point out a palm tree. And remember that it is a symbol of triumph that was used for Jesus, the story or the prayer of the Israelites for salvation. And that we could hold fast to the completion of that salvation story with this triumphant entry of Jesus onto death. Today, together, let us look to the redeeming power of Jesus, that in the midst of our own suffering, that we look to God for his salvation. Our journey of life is only as meaningful as we share it with God. Every ounce, every breath, every area of our lives to be shared with Jesus on his journey. Let us pray. Lord, you are the giver of eternal triumph through your son Jesus. Because of Jesus' suffering, we do not suffer in our hearts. Because of Jesus' death, we no longer suffer from unforgiven sin. Jesus, being on the cross, gives us the power to understand your redeeming power, your resurrection power working in us here and now. In places of desolation, in places of suffering, in places of tears, in places of degeneration, help us to look up with hope in all things and trust you. Though rug would be pulled from underneath us, though things may not go our way or as we expected, though we are imperfect and our lives are imperfect and broken in so many places, we know that we are on the road to salvation because of your son's death on the cross. So as we journey into the Holy Week, help us, O God, to know that we live the most extraordinary story of salvation, that you have called us your own. You have called us as your children, and you have called us for a purpose in our lives. You have called us to be recipients of your love and of your grace, showering down upon us. So Lord, we shout, Hosanna in the highest, your kingdom come into our hearts and into our minds. God, you are our Lord, whom we serve. You are our Lord, for whom we live. You are our Lord, who gives us peace. Victory is ours, O God. We claim it in the name of Jesus Christ. Hosanna in the highest. Victory is ours. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As we sing our consecration praise, let's just think about how Jesus is a different kind of king. Jesus is the king of kings, not because he acts like kings of this earth, but a different kind of king.
Hosanna in the highest.
It is time to pray together in our intercessory prayer. And you will have noticed that in the foyer in the back, one of the boards have been dedicated to write your prayer request and post it on there. And it has a couple of purposes. One, so that when you're walking in and out, that you look at prayer requests, people's prayer requests, so that you may pause and pray on those things. It is also an opportunity for you to use a small piece of paper in the back to write your prayers and post it there so that others can also pray together. It is my prayer that we continue to be in our intercessory prayer, praying for one another. There is power to that, so that we can share our journeys and sufferings, and as well as great things that God has been doing, so that these stories tell of our journey that is aligned with that of Jesus. So please look at those. Some of you who have submitted your prayer requests, you'll see that yours is posted up there. And we ask that you continue to put them in the offering basket on Sundays. We will pray and then post them, right? So, so that we would pray for them, and I will add them to the list so that we can continue to pray for one another. And we have a long list of a separate prayer list that we have kept for 2 years in our Wednesday Bible study group. And so we have hundreds and hundreds of prayer requests, and all of you have been named in that prayer list as we hear of things that we need to pray for one another. Today, we continue to pray for those who are in the hospital, namely Rudy Babutas, Dick Pendleton, and my dad, Joseph O. We also want to pray for Rochelle, Melinda's daughter, who is traveling to Mexico. Speaking of traveling, my husband and I will be traveling this afternoon to Ohio, of all places. Yes, that's where he's from. We're flying to Ohio this afternoon to do a college visit. Yeah, so he's from there, and I want to hear everything about life in Ohio, but my son may end up going to school in Ohio to an aerospace engineering program out there, which just is so far away for a mother to take. So be in prayer for our travel this afternoon. We'll be back tomorrow. We're just going in and coming out. So be in prayer for travel mercies for my husband, myself, and our son. And our daughter will stay home by herself, so please pray for her as well. We continue to pray for all those who are weak due to age and have issues, medical issues. We continue to pray for Flor Santos. We pray for Albier Unan, who all continues to have a lot of back pain and is in a lot of suffering, and will need a lot of your attention as he is asking for your companionship, your friendship. And I want to thank those of you who have been responding to Albier's call for relationship and friendship. Please continue to pray for our ministries. Our preschool has grown, and many calls coming in, particularly for our infant care. So please continue to pray for safe operation and spiritual operation, as it is a part of our ministry. And we pray for Quan as he continues to provide that spiritual leadership to our preschoolers who are at 18 in our roster. So that's a very, very good number. And our capacity is 30 preschool and 12 infant, so a total of 42. So we have a bit of a ways to go. We have space, but we have been very diligent. We have been operating a very safe preschool, and we just ask you to continue to pray for that leadership. We want to also pray for all those suffering from Russia's war in Ukraine, all those who are suffering, and the adjacent countries that are trying to figure out how to deal with refugees and provide help. We also want to pray for the leadership of this nation as they aid the people on humanitarian grounds. So let us pray. God, we thank you for blessing us, and we know that in the midst of all these chaos that we speak of in our personal lives and globally around the world and in this nation, we know that we need you. We need you to be our king. We need you and your rulership and your reign in our hearts and in our nation and in this world. So Lord, we pray for those who are suffering, so many affected in such inhumane ways. Lord, be with them. Bring your peace upon the leaders at war. Lord, we also pray for this nation and its leadership. Help us to stand strong on the side of justice, on the side of peace. Give them courage so that they can stand for the people, for your people, for the protection of all. Lord, we also pray for those who are bedridden among us, those who are suffering due to illnesses. Lord, we ask that the power that the woman felt just by a touch of your cloak will fall upon us and give us healing, give us a renewed spirit. Impart upon us your power, the power of resurrection, the power of the triumphant entry of Jesus. Lord, we also pray for those who are who have prayer needs of unspoken needs that are deep in their hearts. Hear the desires of our hearts. Hear the desire of our hearts. Bring healing to depressing thoughts. Bring healing to thoughts of despair. Bring healing to our mental health. Help us to go to you, Jesus, during this Holy Week and just immerse ourselves in therapy, oh God, with you. We need you. We need you in our hearts. In the name of Jesus Christ, hear our prayers. Amen. Let us rise from our seats as we go from this place. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his love, grace, mercy, and peace to rule in your hearts now and forever. Amen.
Thank you. you.